Transformation is the process by which foreign DNA is introduced into bacterial cells. Plasmid transformation is an important technique for microbiology experiments because it allows plasmids to be stored and replicated in bacteria. Scientists use genetic modifications and chemical treatments to create bacterial cells that are easy to transform. These are known as competent cells. In this video, we will show you how to use a standard transformation protocol to introduce plasmid DNA into competent cells in order to store and replicate your plasmid of interest. At the end of this video, we will talk about two alternative protocols that can significantly reduce transformation time or improve efficiency. To start the transformation process, thaw an aliquot of frozen chemically competent cells on ice for 30 minutes. There are several different types of chemically competent cells available commercially. You can also make your own using commercial kits or do-it-yourself protocols available online. Once acquired, competent cells are usually stored at negative 80 degrees Celsius. Multiple freeze-thaw cycles can reduce competent cell viability. To limit competent cell exposure to multiple freeze-thaw cycles, you should aliquot your cells into small volumes prior to storage and only thaw the amount required for your experiment directly prior to performing your transformation. As the competent cells thaw, place the appropriate LB auger plates on your bench. These plates should contain the antibiotic that your plasmid of interest will provide resistance to. The plates will reach room temperature by the time we're ready to spread our transformed cells. Next, add the plasmid DNA to the competent cells. Add between 10 picograms to 100 nanograms of plasmid DNA to your cells. Mix the cells and DNA by gently flicking the tube with your finger. We use DH5 alpha cells for most of our transformations because they are efficiently transformed by many plasmids. As a control, you should also mix a separate aliquot of competent cells with water and carry these through the rest of the transformation process. These cells should not grow once plated, but will give you confidence that your antibiotic works properly. Be sure to carefully label your samples and controls so you don't confuse them along the way. Next, heat shock the DNA competent cell mixture by placing the tube in a floating rack inside a 42 degrees Celsius water bath for 45 seconds. Then place the tube on ice for 2 minutes. This change in temperature increases the permeability of the bacterial cell membrane and allows the plasmid to enter the cells. After heat shock, we allow the transformed cells to grow for a short period of time in a shaking incubator. During this outgrowth step, the transformed bacteria are incubated in a rich medium-like SOC, which contains glucose. This brief period gives the bacteria time to generate the antibiotic resistance proteins encoded in the plasmid backbone. This step is not as critical for plasmids containing ampicillin resistance and can be skipped in instances where ampicillin is used. To start the outgrowth step, first add 500 microliters of SOC to the tube containing the transformed bacterial cells. Next, place the tube in a shaking incubator at 37 degrees Celsius for 45 minutes. To increase the number of colonies you get after plating, you can concentrate your cells after the outgrowth step by centrifuging. We usually centrifuge the cells for 5 minutes at 4,000 RPM or 1,500 Gs. After you've removed some of the supernatant, you can resuspend the cells and pipette them on top of a warmed LB auger plate containing the necessary antibiotic. If you use pipette tips that are easy to bend, like ours, you can also use them as spreaders when plating the cells. Be careful when bending the tip and make sure you are using good sterile technique throughout the process. The last step is to place the auger plate into an incubator for overnight growth. While most strains require incubation at 37 degrees Celsius, some may require lower incubation temperatures, such as 30 degrees Celsius. After overnight incubation, inspect your plates for visible colony growth. Remember, your control plate should have no visible colonies present. If your sample plate has colonies that are too close together, you can pick a clump of cells and streak for single colonies on a new plate. See our Streaking for Single Colonies video for more information. Although this protocol will work for most plasmids, it can be shortened for easy-to-transform plasmids or altered for plasmids that are difficult to transform. If you want to significantly reduce the time needed for transformation, skip the heat shock and outgrowth steps entirely and simply incubate the DNA competent cell mixture on ice for 5 minutes before plating. This could impact your transformation efficiency, but will work for samples that are easy to transform. You might not always get transformance the first time you try. This could be due to the reagents you use or the size of the construct you are transforming. You should check that your competent cells are still viable and that you use the right antibiotic. If your construct is larger than 10 kilobases, it is a good idea to use electrocompetent cells and an electroporator instead of heat shock. Unlike chemical transformation, which relies on heat shock to cause the cells to take up DNA, electroporation uses an electric field to induce membrane permeability and often leads to higher transformation efficiency. Thank you for watching Agene's transformation protocol video. Check out our other protocol pages at agene.org/protocols. Leave a comment below to let us know what videos you'd like to see in the future or to tell us how we can improve. Agene, a better way to share science.